I am honored to have the opportunity to share my story with you, and I want to assure you from the very beginning that I'm not going to talk for an hour, although my story probably would take that much or longer. I have been known to talk a long time, but I know that the ear can't take more than the rear. And you've been sitting for a long time, so I don't want to cause any discomfort. I am so happy that we have students here today, because that's what I've always been about. I've been an educator for all of my life, and I'm just so happy to have them here. The Odyssey students, who are students of Sylvia Hutchinson. So I am happy that you are here, and I wish you well as freshman students and hope that you will do your very best, and we know that we'll see your names on the graduation list very soon. Now, I want to give you a little background, and first of all, I don't have a written speech, and let me explain to you, I'm not eliciting sympathy, but I have a very serious vision problem. Now, I have macular degeneration in both eyes, and it prevents, and it has gone now to what's called Swiss cheese vision, where you don't see all of anything. If I'm looking at a word, I don't see the whole word. I only see a part of it. I can't even see my face in the mirror in the morning, not in its entirety, and that's probably a blessing. But, so if you see me on campus or anywhere, and I seem not to say anything to you, it's because I don't see you. But I wanted to make a little outline so I would stay on target and that way not keep you too long. I was born in Atlanta, Georgia. Was very segregated. It was on Flag Day in 1936, which means I'm older than dirt. But Atlanta was very segregated at the time. And I had an older brother. He was 18 months older. He wasn't too happy to have me take his place. When I came along, he got less attention. But we got along fine. My parents, my father was John Henry Early, and he only had an elementary school education because he had to work on a sharecropper's farm and help his family. He didn't get a chance to go on to any higher education. My mom was born in Monroe, Georgia, which is just down the road, as you know. And she did not go to college, but she did finish high school. And she became a teacher in a one-room schoolhouse. Now, back then, they would allow, I don't know whether white and black, but they would allow black teachers to teach if they felt that they were competent enough. And apparently they felt that she was, and she was very smart. So growing up in Atlanta, as a child, I went to an elementary school that was on double sessions. How many of you know what double sessions are? Okay. We went to school for half day because the school was so overcrowded that you had to have two groups of students. And my brother and I always went in the mornings because we went in the afternoon to my father's restaurant, which was on the famous Auburn Avenue. Let me go back to the school. We didn't have a lunchroom. We didn't have a playground, just an old dirt-packed yard. We did not ever get new textbooks. We always got books that came from the white schools. When they got new books, we got the old ones. And the name of the school was stamped in the front. And often, pages were torn out or written on. Anyway, I never had a new textbook until I was in the 11th grade at Turner High School. But we had teachers who were dedicated and who actually helped us along, encouraged us. I remember that in the 6th grade, if you came to school without your homework, our teacher would have students to come up to the front of the room. She'd have a bench and they'd have to bend over it, and she used a yardstick, and you know what she did. They didn't arrest teachers back then for doing that. And I'm not advocating violence toward children, but they learned. And we didn't have EMR students. Everybody learned in the same classroom. But when we went to the restaurant, my brother was allowed to stay in the restaurant and help my mother and father, but I was escorted across the street to the only library that there was for blacks at the time. It was called the Auburn Avenue Branch Library. And I think I read almost every book in that library. But I feel that that experience of reading, of course, we had books at home. I was not what you would consider. We were not poor, and we weren't rich. We were sort of in the middle because my father owned his own business. But as I grew up, I noticed all of the differences that the segregation made, the Jim Crow laws made in our lives. For instance, if you went to a store to buy purchased clothing, you could not try those clothes on. You had to look at it and eyeball it and buy it. And if it didn't fit, you didn't take it back. We had to go to the back of the shoe store, and they wouldn't let us try those shoes on, but there were just a lot of things. Blacks sat at the back of the streetcar. They have new streetcars in Atlanta now, but I'm not all that. I mean, I haven't ridden in them because I grew up riding streetcars. But at any rate, we sat at the back of the bus. We couldn't go to the movies downtown or to restaurants. I didn't mind about the restaurants because we had our own. But there were just a lot of things that bothered me, even as a child. So I went through elementary school, through high school, and when I was in the 11th grade, I was transferred to Turner High School, and that's important because both Charlene Hunter and Hamilton Holmes were also graduates of Turner. I was in the first graduating class, and they were 5 years after me. So I knew them. I knew Charlene because I had written the school song, the alma mater for Turner High, since I was in the first class. And she asked to interview me because even then in high school, she was interested in journalism. I knew Hamilton because he was on the football team. He was a very valued football player. I think he was a quarterback. At any rate, I knew both of them. So when our paths crossed again, the University of Georgia, they were not unknown to me. I knew them. I left high school and went at the age of 16 to college. I went to Clark College. I had a scholarship because I was the valedictorian of my high school. I had a scholarship to Smith College in Massachusetts, but it was an all-girls school. And I had a scholarship to Spelman College in Atlanta, and it was an all-girls school. And I decided I didn't want an all-girls school. I wanted a co-ed school. I wanted to be well-rounded. And so I went to Clark College. But that's not really the reason. The reason is because my band director, who was very charismatic in high school, he took me to Clark College, and I could rehearse with the band as a senior. And I thought that was really big time, that I was able to play in a college band, and I was just in high school. I liked the band director at Clark, and so I decided I'd go there, and I did. I wrote a diary my freshman week at Clark, and I think it presaged what happened to me in coming here. I was so glad that I had this opportunity for college to be able to go to school, and I wish that all of the freshmen all over the world could have had the same wonderful week that I had had. And I hope that one day we would look upon each other as the human race and not as white race or colored race. And I don't know why at the age of 17 that was on my mind, but it was. I finished college and started my first job. And it was at John Hope Elementary School, which was about two blocks from Martin Luther King Jr.'s church, Ebenezer. This school is on Boulevard. But anyway, I was in my fourth year of teaching, and I was teaching music, of course, and I loved teaching. I had some wonderful students. I had a 40-piece elementary band, which was kind of unusual. I told the students a few minutes ago that being a band director was not what most women did. It was not you know, things were really determined by gender. You were supposed to be a nurse or a teacher, but you weren't supposed to teach band. But I was always an out-of-the-box kind of person, and I decided I didn't teach just band. I taught general music, I taught chorus, but I really enjoyed teaching instrumental music because of the influence of my high school band director. Well, I was in my fourth year of teaching. This was January of 1961. I went home. I was still living with my mother. My father had passed when I was 12. I went home and had dinner. I had worked late and I was tired, and we sat down in front of our little, I think it was probably 25-inch black and white television, and saw a riot that was going on down here. I was appalled. I said, they made the students, they made Charlene and Hamilton, they suspended them for their own safety, because the riot erupted. So, well, they said because there was a basketball game and Georgia got beaten by Georgia Tech. But actually, that riot had been planned. I don't have any proof of that, but there are a lot of people who say the same thing. And so they were escorted back to Atlanta for their own safety. I knew about the court case that had gone on, the fact that they had to go on to school and transfer. I mean, they were transferees because Hamilton was a student at Morehouse College and Charlene was a student at Wayne State University in Detroit. While the court case was going on, they had been selected while they were at Turner High School as seniors, as students who probably would be able to be admitted to the University of Georgia. But people in Georgia, a lot of the legislators particularly, and the governor, decided that that was not what they wanted to happen. I've often been asked, why did you decide to go? Well, as I sat and I watched that newscast and watched them throw rocks not only at Charlene's dorm, now Hamilton was not involved with that because he lived off campus with the Killian family, but as I watched that, I thought, what cowardice. How can they can't treat them that way. They are Turner High classmates of mine. They weren't classmates, but they were Turner High students. And so I said to my mom, I'm going to transfer from the University of Michigan. I had been going to the University of Michigan for 2 summers, and I was majoring in music at the graduate level. I thought that, and I still think that, University of Michigan has one of the best music programs in the whole nation. And so my mother said, you want to do what? And I said, I'm going to transfer to the University of Georgia. And she said, no, I don't think you want to do that. You see what's happening. I said, well, it's just something I have to do. Well, when people ask me why did I make that decision, I think back, and the truth of the matter is, although I really was the first to get a degree, any degree here, I was not in a race with Charlene and Hamilton. I wanted to do something. I had grown up in segregated Atlanta, and I saw what effect the Jim Crow laws, both written and unwritten, had on the lives of black citizens. And at that time, if you remember, 1960 was when the student movement started. They were picketing the stores. They were marching and saying to the older black leaders, we're tired of this. We want freedom now. We want equality now. And I agreed with them. Now, when I went to college, when I went to my first job, I was barely 21 because my birthday was in June. And I was a year ahead, but I was a young teacher. I was 24 years of age. And I thought, I can't stand idly by on the sidelines and see how this plays out with the student movement. I've got to do something. I've got to be active. I've got to make a mark in terms of my own goals. And my goal is to help in this struggle for human equality. And that's why I went. Well, 3 days after the riot, I sent one application. My mother eventually decided, well, if you really are determined that you're going to go, I will support you. And she did. I talked with my principal, Mr. Long, and he was eager. He said, I think that's a great idea. So you see, I was really self-selected. Nobody asked me to go. And I knew that whatever happened, I would have to take responsibility for it because it was nobody's fault but my own. But when I sent for the application, I got it back very quickly. I decided that I would talk with Mr. Jesse Hill. He had been recommended to me by Mr. Long, my principal, because Jesse Hill was one of the people, one of the leaders who helped to select Charlene Hunter and Hamilton Holmes. And Mr. Long felt that he could give me good advice, and he did. He accompanied me to the courthouse. I had to get a signature from the judge of the Superior Court saying that I was an upstanding citizen. I don't know how he was supposed to know, because I didn't know him, and he certainly didn't know me. But that was one of the subterfuges that Georgia had at the time. I don't know how many of you understand or remember what happened during that era. First of all, they passed a law that said that if you were over 25, you could not enter school. You had to be under 25. Well, now for graduate students, that doesn't make any sense. They eventually, before I even made my application, that law was struck down by the courts because it was hurting white students as well as black. The second thing was they wanted you to get the signatures of two Georgia UGA alums who could verify as to your good character. Well, I didn't know any University of Georgia alums. It was a segregated society. I didn't come into contact with any. Well, that too was thrown out. But you did have to go to the courthouse, and I asked my friend Betty, and I want you all to thank her with me for getting me up, well, coming and getting me at 6 o'clock this morning. I had to get up at 4:30, and bringing me down because I had something else last night and could not get here. And thank you, Betty, for being a good friend. But I asked Betty if she had seen on her application, because she too is a Georgia alum, if there was a place for alumni signatures, and she doesn't remember. When you get our age, folk, it's hard to remember everything, I'll tell you. But at any rate, we also had to have Mr. Hill went with me. He accompanied me to the courthouse to get the signature. And the judge didn't sign it. It was the clerk of court. And he didn't ask any questions. He just signed it. And I sent the application in. And I also requested transcripts from Clark College and University of Michigan. Well, that was when things started happening, because I don't think they really knew that I was black until they got the transcript from Clark College. Well, I had graduated high school and college as a valedictorian, so I knew that my grades would be okay. But I didn't know what other kinds of things they were trying to put in the way. And it took 5 months before I was finally, people think that, you know, they just accepted the application. That is not what happened. They did everything they could to try and disallow my entrance here. They already had the two freshmen, I mean, not freshmen, they already had the two undergraduates, because Hamilton and Charlene were also transfer students. I transferred from the University of Michigan, and they from Morehouse and Wayne State University. At any rate, what I didn't know was that supposedly the GBI did an investigative report, which I have a copy of, but I did not know that it existed until the year 2000. And when I read it, I was just really insulted, because it asked questions such as, did I shoplift? Was I listed in the health department as having a venereal disease? They asked three times if I'd had an illegitimate child. It was just insulting. They had my salary, what I was making, and they didn't investigate just me. They investigated my entire family, even my father, who was dead at the time. At any rate, they couldn't find anything that would keep me from being admitted, and I did come to campus. I was not invited, but I decided on spring break that I would come to campus to have an interview, the required interview, with Walter N. Danner, who was the registrar. And he had his, excuse me, he had his assistant registrar, Paul Key, there. And the first person that I talked with on campus was the dean of the graduate school, Dean Huff. And he was very nice. We had a pleasant conversation. He told me he didn't think there would be any problem with my being admitted. And I'm thinking, well, it's been since January and I haven't heard anything. But anyway, then I went to see Mr. Danner. And he said to me, well, have you ever been in a house of prostitution? And I said, no, I'm a professional. I'm a teacher. I have no need of a house of prostitution. And then he said, well, you know, you've got two summers at the University of Michigan. We don't have to accept any of that, and you would lose all of that, and you'd lose all that money and time. And I said to him, Mr. Danner, what I have learned, I won't lose, and I still want to go to Georgia. At that time, the state was paying black teachers the difference between tuition and, I believe, room and board, I'm not sure, to go to a school away from Georgia so that they wouldn't try to get into the University of Georgia. They wanted to maintain segregation on the segregated system. And that's why I was able to go to the University of Michigan. Now, they didn't pay everything, but they called them grant in aids. And he was saying that they didn't have to accept the credits from you. I thought to myself, University of Michigan, one of the top 10 universities, and you're not going to accept? I said, it's okay. I still want to come to the University of Georgia. So about, I guess, 20 days before I was to come to campus, I got a letter of admission. And I was so happy because I thought, you know, the first hurdle has been mastered. I can do this. I'm going to the University of Georgia. They had reinstated Charlene Hamilton after the riot, and there had not been any other acts of violence. And truth of the matter is, I wasn't afraid. I didn't even think about that. I think I was too stupid to be afraid. I don't know. But at any rate, I came down on June the 12th, yes, to register. And somehow someone had set a young lady from North Carolina, her name was Mae March, a white student, art student, who was a graduate student in art and was just about to get her master's. She met me at the office of Dr. Kelly, who was a black dentist here in the city of Athens. And we went to registration. And Stegman was a gymnasium then. It was not a coliseum. And as we approached the line of march, the line was all out the door, and the students were talking loudly. And as we approached and they looked up and saw us, it was quieter than it is in here now. And we continued to talk. We did not stop talking, and nothing happened. But that was one of the, I guess I was more nervous at that moment than any on campus. Well, I got registered, and I found that I was to be housed in the same dorm that Charlene had just left because they had gone home for the summer. So I was the lone black student on campus. And things were going along okay, except that I was being ostracized. And it was very lonely because I'm a very talkative person, as you can hear. I talk a lot, too much probably. But at any rate, I had gone to my classes. On the third day, it was my 25th birthday. And nobody had talked to me, and students would sit as far away as they could. You see, I thought that graduate students would be more mature, would be more tolerant than the undergraduates, but such was really not the case. And the reason was not that they were all bigots people. They were afraid that they would be criticized. In fact, there had been a proclamation that was circulated around campus. I have a copy of it. that said that we will not welcome these students. We will ignore them, and if any white students befriend them, we will ignore them too. So, and they did. But when I got back to the dorm that day on my 25th birthday, I had a call from Dr. Popovich, who was a speech teacher here. He had befriended me by sending a letter of welcome before I even came to campus. It's the only letter of welcome I got. But he had called the house mother, Mrs. Porter, and told her to tell me, to ask me if I was interested in having hot dogs over at the Student Presbyterian Center, which was really very close to Santa Maria's dorm. And I said, of course I'm interested. So he came and picked me up, and I went across with him and the street with him, and found, after meeting the Presbyterian minister, Corky King was his name. His name was really Hardin, H-A-R-D-I-N, but everybody called him Corky. He was later fired or encouraged to leave because of his liberal views. But at any rate, I found that they had actually planned a picnic, a birthday party for me, and I couldn't believe it. There was even a decorated cake and ice cream and hot dogs and hamburgers. It's the first time I'd had a chance to sit down and eat with someone. You see, in Sinemeyer's room, they had a little kitchenette and they had a private bath, and they hoped that Charlene at first and then me, they hoped that we would cook our own meals and use the bathroom there. But I didn't go down there to cook, so I didn't. I don't think Charlene did either. So it was good to have people. But the most important thing was these were people who did not know me. And I couldn't believe that they would plan a birthday. How they found out it was my birthday, I have no idea. But it was wonderful because I thought, you know, maybe it's not going to be so bad after all. Well, that day passed, but it was probably the best birthday I have ever had because I was so impressed with the goodness of people who are not afraid to stand up for what is right. There were some other instances where Corky King had to come to my rescue. A lot of things happened that first summer, and I'm not going to dwell on those because I've worked hard to forget many of them. I am in the process, and I hope I'll be able to finish. I'm in the process of writing my memoirs simply because I want it written for historical purposes so that people can know the story coming from me, my story. But I thought that things were going to be different, as I said, because I thought that graduate students would be different. But they were just as, they ostracized me as much as undergraduate students had done with Charlene and Hamilton initially. But when the 4th of July weekend turned around, we were supposed to, in my advanced history class, we were supposed to have the test before the holidays, but other students wanted the test to be held afterwards. And I studied, I wanted to get it over with. But at any rate, make a long story short, I had the highest score on the test. And after then, some of them started talking to me in class, not outside of class, but I guess they wanted to figure out who this person was and why was she making a higher score than them. But the bad things that happened, there was only one instance where some violence, and that was when they were throwing rocks at me. They threw lemons, but the lemons are okay, they don't hurt. But the rocks made me angry. Now you have to understand that when I went home on weekends, when I could go home, I always went to Dr. King's church because I needed to hear his philosophy of nonviolence and his talk about brotherhood and peace and love. It gave me the strength and the courage that I needed to go on the next week forward, because you never knew what was going to happen. And one incident, I was walking to the post office to mail a letter to my mother 70 miles away. See, folks, there were no cell phones, there were no computers. You had an electric typewriter if you had anything. And if you needed to correspond with somebody, you couldn't text them and you couldn't talk to them on the phone. You had to, well, they had telephones now, but there was no phone in my room or in our room. And so the only time you could talk on the phone, you had to go and use a house mother's phone, and there was no privacy. So I was going to the post office to take this letter, and these young men were across the street, and I was walking, minding my own business, and they started taunting me with racial epithets, and I ignored them. And when I ignored them, they started throwing rocks at me. And one of them hit me on the cheek underneath my glasses. I've always worn glasses. And it made me angry, and I picked up the rock and I threw it back. I didn't hit anybody. They ran on down the street laughing. But when I went to church, I did go home that weekend. I went to church. I said to Dr. King after church, you know, I've not been nonviolent, and I told him what happened. And he said, don't worry about it, Mary Frances, I would have done the same thing. I don't believe that, but it did teach me one thing. I mean, I don't know what you're supposed to do when people are throwing rocks at you, but anyway, that's beside the point. I was encouraged at the end of that summer, that first summer, by my advisor to come back, take a leave of absence from my job, come back the spring of 1962, and he said, and you possibly, if you continued through the summer, you possibly could receive your degree. And it was a possibility, and I thought, well, okay, I'll think about it. So I went home, I talked with my mom, and I talked with my principal. He said, I'll hold your job. Don't worry about it. If you want to take a leave, just make application to the school system, and we'll see to it that you have a job when you come back. And so I did, but I thought, how am I going to finance it? Because I won't have a salary, I won't have health insurance and the other perks that teachers have. But I thought, you know, a way will be made. And believe it or not, the professional teacher organizations were segregated at the time. The white teachers organization was the Georgia Teacher Association. And the Black Teachers Association, the state, was the GTEA, the Georgia Teacher Education Association. And there was a satellite in Atlanta, the Gate City Teachers Association. Well, Horace Ward, Dr. Horace Ward, was the executive secretary. And he, and I believe Mr. Hill, decided that they would ask the teachers to donate some money to help me with my expenses. And that they did. They asked the teachers to donate $1 or $2. And one teacher called and said, you know, you're crazy. You don't need to be going back down there. You know, they can kill you. And I'm not going to help you with that. I'm not sending you anything. And I said, well, you know, I didn't really ask you to. And I'm not afraid that anything is going to happen. But I understand that money is tight, so that's fine. But in the end, they had donated over $2,000, and with other contributions from my church and my school, the PTA. Even I have a record of the people who gave me money. One student gave me $1. Now, back in those days, I mean, I was only making like $3,000 a year for salary, but $1 was a lot of money. And I thought, all these people are helping me. You know, all of us, somebody has to help. You don't do anything alone, folks. And I felt so good about the encouragement, the support that I got from family, from friends, from church members. I felt, you know, I can do this, and I can't let these people down. And I didn't. But the second, when I went back for the spring semester, one thing that happened, I thought, well, you know, things are going to be better, I believe, because a whole semester has passed. But when I went to this class called Personality and Social Adjustment, the professor asked all the students to stand around the perimeter of the room, and then he proceeded to seat the students alphabetically. And when he got to the E's, he went right on by, and at the end of the last student, there were probably 20 or 30 students in the class. The last student was named Zion, and he said to me, you sit after behind him. And I said, no, my name begins with an E. You skip by me. He said, you'll sit where I tell you. And I said, no, I won't. And I walked out. I went to the dean's office, Dean Williams, and explained to him what happened. And of course, he just assigned me to another section of that class. So things were still not as I thought they should be. But I got through all of my requirements, and on August the 16th, they had not allowed me. By the way, I was in the summer school chorus, and I had wanted to invite my mom and my brother and friends to a concert because I was selected to sing in a small ensemble, and I was told, no, you cannot invite anyone because the university is only integrated for you, Charlene, and Hamilton. I didn't tell you that when I came back for the spring semester, I roomed with Charlene in that same room in Center Myers. There were two rooms that could be considered bedrooms. And we got along okay because although there was a 5-year difference between us, I'd known her from high school and she knew me. But we had no classes together because she was in journalism and undergraduate. I was in music education and a graduate. We went to a dinner a couple of times, but most of the time we just saw each other at the dorm, and we did not talk about whatever problems we had. That was not something that we wanted to discuss. It took itself out on us in various ways, but we did not share. And I think right now, I think upon that as being rather strange, but I did not ask when I graduated. I just invited my family, my friends, and there was a convoy of about 74 people in cars who came to Athens. It's probably the first time there had been that many blacks in the commencement audience. As I approached the line to find my place among the music ed majors, nobody spoke to me. I didn't speak to them. It was very lonely. I mean, it was not the way you're supposed to. Everybody is deliriously happy, and you don't find silence at a graduation line, but that's what I found. And one thing was funny because I saw this man up in front of the line with a big sword, and I thought, are they expecting trouble? I didn't know that that was a tradition that dated back many, many years. At any rate, we went in, had the graduation. We had a speaker. He was Dr. Irvin Ingram, I think his name was. He was emeritus president of West Georgia College, and I swear to you, I don't remember a thing he said. That's why graduation speakers don't need to worry, because nobody's going to remember what they said anyway. But at any rate, we got through, and when we were to toss our tassels, I tossed my tassels. You didn't go up on the stage. They didn't call your name. There were about 600 graduates, and they were graduates and undergraduate students at this commencement. My friends and family waited for me outside. They had told us, and I don't know if this was a tradition for every graduation or just for mine, they said, you turn in your cap and your gown at the door. It was at the Fine Arts Auditorium. So when I got to the door, I took off my cap and gown, gave it to them. I didn't get an official picture. There were no media present. So this is why I was essentially forgotten by UGA. Although I felt very victorious because I had reached my goal. I had reached my goal because of the help and the support many, many people who now I felt UGA would be changed forever. There would be others that came after me, I knew. And so I went back to UGA in 64 through 67, and I received a second degree because there still were not enough people of color here. And after that, I heard nothing from UGA until the year, actually 2000. Before then, in 1997, Maurice Daniels, who was at that time a professor in the School of Social Work, now he's dean, he called me and said, Miss Early, I've been talking with Donald Hollowell, who was the chief counsel for Charlene Hunter and Hamilton Homes, and I am told that you actually were the first black to get a degree. And I said, yes, that's true. He said, well, I knew nothing about it. I don't know how long he'd been on the campus at the time. He said, I'm going to do a little research, and then I'll be back in touch. And so he did. He's a very meticulous man as far as scholarship is concerned, and he didn't just take my word. He did his research and found Yami. She was the first one. He said, well, I don't know why you haven't been recognized, but I'm doing a documentary on Horace Ward. It was Judge Horace Ward, who was actually the first black to apply to the University of Georgia, but he was not accepted. They rejected his application. And I think it was poetic justice that he was one of the young lawyers who helped Donald Hollowell in his court case against the University of Georgia on behalf of Charlene Hunter and Hamilton Holmes. At any rate, he did this documentary, and he included Charlene and Hamilton, who was still living at the time, and he included me. And in the year 2000, I was invited to come back to campus to speak at the annual lecture for the GAPS. GAPS is the Graduate and Professional Scholars, mainly minority graduate students. They're getting their master's or specialist or PhD degrees. And I thought about whether or not I wanted to go back, because after I left the University of Georgia, I went on with my career, and it was a glorious career, and I was still participating in it. At any rate, I thought, yeah, I think I will go back. And so I entitled my speech, Integrating the University of Georgia, the Early Years, meaning my name, number one, early, and number two, meaning that it was a long time ago. And at that very lecture, the lecture was renamed in my honor, and I received a proclamation from President Michael Adams verifying or confirming the fact that I was indeed UGA's first graduate and first black to get a degree. I felt so vindicated. I felt that at last, at least my role, however minor, was being recognized, because people, it's not comfortable being the invisible man or woman. And it's not good when you feel that you've just been ignored. To this day, I don't know why. But since that time, the University of Georgia has really just overwhelmed me with recognitions, accolades. And I feel just like a regular person. I mean, I don't feel like I'm anything special. But I do feel pride in being part of a university that has made such a turnaround since 1961 and 62. It is so different. And I tell that to students all of the time. And it makes me feel good when they come up to me, as Elizabeth said, and said, oh, I know you. You're famous. I said, no, I'm not famous. But they say, thank you for paving the way. And that, to me, is worth more than gold, because it makes you feel that you've been part of something good. Something, you know, they say if you don't remember history, you're liable to repeat it. That's actually true. And I don't want UGA to repeat what happened years and years ago. I don't know how many of you remember the name of Governor Ernest Vandiver, but he was a governor at the time who said, no, not one, meaning black person, only they didn't call him black then. It was either colored or Negro or the other word. Not one will integrate the schools. And if they do, we're going to close them, because back in Marvin Griffin's day, they had passed, Georgia had passed a law saying that any school that was desegregated would not receive state funding. And of course, it would have to close. But right after the riot here, Governor Vandiver was able to encourage or urge the General Assembly to repeal that law, because they didn't want to close the University of Georgia. Their kids were in school here, and they didn't want to lose the education that they knew that Georgia could provide. And plus, Governor Vandiver was a UGA grad himself. And unlike the state of Virginia, Georgia did much better. That riot was the worst thing that happened that was palpable, but people, there are a lot more ways you can lynch a person than just with a rope. And those days were not pleasant, but they were so worth it, because now we can look at our institution and all of us be proud of it. I'm proud to be a part of the Bulldog Nation, and I'm even prouder to be part of this Board of Visitors for the College of Education. Thank you so much for listening, and I hope your ears are okay.